Hi, I'm Daniel, and this is The Rabbit Hole, the series where we discover digital audio technology and see how deep the rabbit hole goes. In this set, we'll learn how to use a compressor, how it works on the inside, and eventually, we'll even program a compressor of our very own. So, what's a compressor used for? It's the process of mapping the dynamic range of an audio signal to a smaller range. That means lowering loud sounds or amplifying quiet sounds in order to get a more static or even balance of the audio volume. So let's take the example of a vocal track. The singer might have performed at different intensity levels, leaving some words loud and strong, but other words very quiet and mumbled. And how can we achieve a good level for that? If we set our levels so that the strong words are clear and comfortable, then the quiet, mumbled words will be difficult to hear. Maybe it'll be difficult to even hear what's being said. While at the same time, if we set our level so that the quiet words are clear and comfortable, then the strong words will be uncomfortably loud or even distorted. We solve that with compression. And what we do is we automatically reduce the volume of the loud words while leaving the quiet words unaltered. And this reduces the overall difference between quiet and loud words. And this way we can get a better overall level of our vocal track. With that being said, let's have a closer look and get into some real funny computer business. Beep, boop, boop. You'll find compressors included with most audio software, but for the purposes of this demonstration, I'll use Ableton Live with Isotope Ozone because that's what I like and I like what I like. And Ozone also has some good displays to help us visualize some of these concepts. In order to get started, there are a few parameters we need to know about to use the compressor. The first being threshold. The threshold defines the level, usually in decibels, from which we want compression to occur. In the case of most compressors, that means defining an upper limit. When the audio level goes above this upper limit, the volume will be lowered. This is called downward compression, which is a term we'll get back to in a later video. This transitions us to the next parameter, which is the ratio. And essentially, the ratio is the amount to lower the volume when it's above the threshold. Like the word implies, the ratio defines the ratio of the compressed volume compared to the original volume. So let's say we had a level that's currently 6 decibels above our threshold. If we had a ratio of 2:1, then that would mean the volume would be lowered by half the amount that it's above the threshold. In this case, with 6 decibels above the threshold and a ratio of 2:1, the signal would be lowered by 3 decibels. If the ratio instead was 3:1, then the signal would be lowered by 4 decibels, which is 2/3 of 6. Finally, if the ratio is 1:1, the volume would not be lowered at all. If this seems confusing to you, don't worry. You can think about it like this. The higher the ratio, the more intense the compression will be when the sound level is above the threshold. When the sound is below the threshold, the volume will still be unchanged. Now let's try that out real quick. So I have Ableton Live here, and I have Ozone, and we'll close this up real quick. And I have a dynamic guy. Let's have a listen real quick what he has to say.
Your voice could sound like this if you're not careful about your levels. It could get very quiet or very loud all of a sudden, and you'd have to compress it.
That's a pretty dynamic guy with a lot of levels. And what we'd want to do is we'd want to try and compress this guy so that things that are above, like something like here, maybe will be kind of pushed down to the same level as some of the lower level stuff. We can do that from in here in Ozone. The threshold that I just mentioned is this one. And you can see I can set the level. So if I set, for example, minus 12 decibels, then when the sound level reaches above minus 12 decibels, we'll do something. And you can see it reflected over here as well. And I have my ratio here. So before I had the ratio of 1, and now I'll have a ratio of 2. And you can see that affects the sound above the threshold in some way. If I set a very high ratio, you can see it affects it more. Let's try this out. So I'll start with a ratio of 2, And then I'll try and push the threshold down on this guy and you can hear the effect.
Your voice could sound like this if you're not careful about your levels. It could get very quiet or very loud all of a sudden and you'd have to compress it. Your voice could sound like this if you're not careful about your levels. It could get very quiet or very loud all of a sudden.
Can you hear that the level of the loud voice and the quiet voice comes closer together? If I turn up the ratio even more, you'd tell it even more distinctly.
Your voice could sound like this if you're not careful about your levels. It could get very quiet or very loud all of a sudden and you'd have to compress it.
Now that's some pretty extreme compression, but as you can hear, the volume is almost flat now. So
your voice could sound like this if you're not careful about your levels. It could get very quiet or very loud.
And that's how it works. Another thing I want to show you real quick is makeup gain, because when we compress something that's above a level, so we are turning the volume of loud things down, we'd want to gain the whole thing up again afterwards. We want to compensate for having turned stuff down so we don't get an overall very low level, because that's our baseline. So what we want to do is we'd want to adjust our gain. We can do that here. So if I do some sort of some amount of compression, let's say
your voice could sound like this if you're not careful about your levels. It could get very quiet or very loud.
Something like that maybe good. And then I want to adjust my my makeup gain. And my target for the makeup gain is to get approximately the same amount of loudness that I had before I compressed. This will make it easier to compare and easier for me to tell what I'm actually doing to the signal. So let's try that.
Your voice could sound like this if you're not careful about your levels. It could get very quiet or very loud all of a sudden and you'd have to compress it.
Something like
your
that, maybe.
Your voice could sound like this if you're not careful about your levels. It could get very quiet or very loud all of a sudden and you'd have to compress it.
Yeah. Another important component of compressors is timing, which has a few parameters to it we need to learn as well. In terms of timing, we usually have the opportunity to change the attack and the release. These parameters determine how quickly the compressor will react to changes in levels. In the case of downward compression, the attack decides how quickly the volume will be lowered when the level is above the threshold. This is nice for cases where we don't want the compression to sound too aggressive, like our previous example, or if we want to maintain some punch at the beginning of a loud sound. In contrast, release defines how quickly the compressor will return to a normal level when the sound comes back below the threshold after having been reduced. Again, we can adjust this setting to get more natural sounding level changes for different kinds of sounds. So let me show you that by, let's keep working on this dynamic guy. So as you can see here in Ozone, we have two knobs here, or whatever, two sliders for attack and release. So
your voice could sound like this if you're not careful about your levels.
If I set the attack higher, you'll hear more of a punch and more of a transient in the beginning of each word.
Your voice could sound like this if you're not careful about your levels.
And the reason you do that is because when a loud word comes in, the compressor will actually be slower to react and to turn the volume down. And as a result, you get like an accentuation of the beginning of each word. If I switch to this view, the gain reduction view, you can see how it works.
Your voice could sound like this if you're not careful about your levels.
So this is the gain reduction. If I turn the attack very low,
your voice could sound like this if you're not careful about your levels. It could get very quiet or very loud all of a sudden.
Then it will react immediately. And then we won't have as much accentuation of the punch or the transient at the beginning of each sound. So the same goes for release.
Your voice could sound like this if you're not careful about your levels. It could get very quiet or very loud all of a sudden. And
It's more difficult to hear release, but as you can see, it will return back to normal very quickly when the release is very quick.
Your and voice could if sound I make like it
very slow,
careful about your levels, it could get very quiet.
We see we have these longer, smoother curves of the volume being turned back up, and so let's say that we don't really want to compress that harshly each word, but we instead want to compress more like the average thing. Well, then we'd want to use some slower attack and release settings. So let's say I want to, maybe I want to do 200 milliseconds of attack and 400 or 500 of release.
Your voice could sound like this if you're not careful about your levels. It could get very quiet or very loud all of a sudden.
As you can tell, it's more of a gradual change. And if I do it even more, we'll get even more of a gradual change.
Your voice could sound like this if you're not careful about your levels. It could get very quiet or very loud all of a sudden, and you'd have to compress it.
So that really depends on what you're going for. Sometimes doing slower attack and release settings might not give you what you want. You have to kind of try it out, and different sound sources react slightly different or feels different depending on the speed of the compression you're applying. In the case of vocals, I would probably go for something quick in the attack and something slightly slower in the release, maybe something like 20 milliseconds of attack and maybe 100 of release or something like that.
Your voice could sound like this if you're not careful about your levels. It could get very quiet or very loud all of a sudden, and you're...
That feels good to me, but that's something that you can play around with, and that's how you can work with the timing when compressing a sound. All right, so that's the basics. I hope you learned some stuff about how to use a compressor. It's an essential tool in audio and music production, and that's why it's good to know about. If you feel uncertain about any of these concepts, don't worry. It can be a lot to take in. Feel free to watch this video again and leave your questions in the comments, and I'll try to answer them. Also, I've included some helpful resources in the description if you want to go a little more in depth. There's still quite a few things we haven't covered though, such as knees, peak versus RMS sensing, look ahead, multiband, parallel compression, and in the next video, we'll go deeper down the rabbit hole. All right, well, thank you for watching this video. It's my first in this series, so since there's already quite a bit of like tutorial how-to videos out there, I figured it might be more helpful to do the more technically in-depth series about some of these topics. I want this to be a resource for all you awesome creative people out there, so please leave me your feedback in the comments. I really want to hear from you so I can make the series as helpful as it can be. I guess thank you, and I'll see you soon.